And we are through yet another month of the Kansas City Royals franchise. May has come to an end, and as we get ready to hop into June, we are first going to go over how the team did in May. So at the end of May, we are sitting at 31-26 on the year. That is good enough for first place in the AL Central, a six-game lead on the Cleveland Indians. Even though we were 3-7 in our last 10 games in May, we still have that six-game lead because the entire AL Central has decided to shit the bed. I know this has been a thing that people have commented about. I can't control how this team plays in Sims. Obviously, I can control how the team plays in games, and there have been a couple like blowouts and whatnot, like earlier, like the first two games, I think, were both blowouts that I showed. But, I mean, even if I blew out every single game I post 30-0, it still really doesn't matter what I do in the games that I show. It really all comes down to the Sims, because I only play three games a month. So there's 30, 31 days in a month, probably like two, three off days. It really comes down to how the team does in the Sim. I can't really control how the team does in the Sim other than just putting our team out there, and I'm not going to purposely send down everyone in the major leagues to like double A and just have like a bunch of 50 overall guys in the majors just so I can like please people who want like some ridiculous rebuild. So trust me, I don't want the team to be good either, but even if the team's still in first place, I'm hoping it's like less of a lead. Like a six-game lead is kind of unrealistic to start trading people the deadline, but even if I'm still in first place at the deadline, expect people to be traded, because this team is not going to World Series. This team is not set for the future. This team, it would just be a situation where the GM decides, oh, we're in the playoff race, so we're gonna not trade anybody because we have to keep the illusion up that we're a winning team, when in reality everyone knows they're not winning shit. And then the offseason comes around, they lose all their players, they get nothing for those players. And it's just chaos, because they just lose all these players, they have nothing they replaced them with, and they just have to restart from scratch rather than actually getting something. If the deadline comes around and we're still in first place, what I'm saying is essentially we are still going to be trading talent. Probably not as much talent as I would trade if we were not in the playoff race, but still going to be trading people. And we'll get into who I'm looking at trading or later on in the episode, but first things first, we're going to go over some league leaders. Mainly pitching, because our hitters really aren't doing anything impressive throughout the league. Kelvin Herrera has 20 saves, even though saves not the greatest stat in my opinion. Still, Kelvin Herrera is third in the American League. It is worth mentioning. Jason Hamill has done absolutely amazing through 2 months of the season. A 1.01 whip is second in the American League, and a 1.8 WAR has him at fifth in the AL. And then Danny Duffy has a 109 whip, that's ninth, and then a 1.5 WAR is also ninth in the American League. And now taking a look at our bats, our best bat by far through the first 2 months of the season has been Mike Moustakas. Probably no surprise there. He's slashing 300, 361, or 351, 514. That's an 865 OPS. Leads the team in OPS, leads the team with 12 home runs as well. Jorge Soler, second best bat. Definitely a guy who we're going to have in the future for us, who's going to be a key part of this team in seasons to come. 275, 360, 455 slash line, that's an 815 OPS. Pretty darn good. Only four home runs. You'd like to see him have a bit more power, but I'm not going to complain about the OPS. And then an interesting thing on this team is the catching situation, because we all know that Salvador Perez is our catcher. Even though he only has 1 year left in his deal, I do want to bring him back. I'll get into that a bit later. But Salvador Perez has Drew Butera behind him, who has an 808 OPS. Now, it's only at 42 at-bats, and that's a small sample size, but he's on fire in the game. And then Salvador Perez has the lowest OPS on our team of qualifying hitters. A 522 OPS. Not good at all. Not even remotely good. Not even decent. Not even like, you know, you could be better. Just flat out awful. 522 OPS. Not good. He's getting on base at a 239 rate. Horrible. Awful. Not good. Needs to be better. Lucas Duda, our first baseman, is doing his job. He's got a 767 OPS. He's got 8 home runs. Not the most, not the worst, but he's still doing his job. And he's getting on base at a 358 clip. So he's definitely doing his job, getting on base, hitting home runs, hitting doubles, stuff like that. That's what he's here for. That's what he's doing. Taking a look at John Jay, he has really solidified himself as a guy who can hit against both pitchers, lefties and righties. To start the year, since he's a lefty bat, I had him leading off against righties, or playing center and leading off against righties, and then against lefties, I had Whit Merrifield leading off, and then Paulo Orlando was playing center field. We'll get into why Paulo Orlando is no longer playing center field against lefties, but one of the reasons John Jay is able to do that, or one of the reasons why we don't really miss Orlando playing there, is because John Jay is doing quite well with a 360 OBP. Definitely like something you like to see from a leadoff guy. He's the full-time center fielder now, also the full-time leadoff guy. And speaking of Whit Merrifield, one of the reasons why he's no longer the leadoff guy against lefties is because he can't get on base. Can't hit, can't get on base, can't do shit. Whit Merrifield, 546 OPS, not good. Just slightly better than Salvador Perez, but like I said, Salvador Perez, straight awful. Whit Merrifield, straight awful. They're not playing well right now, they're both slumping. Something concerning about Whit Merrifield is through 2 months of the season, he has zero home runs. Last year, he hit 19. Definitely a bit concerning that he's one of our better rated players and he's not really performing well. And then a guy we have recently called up who is just alternating between right field and DH with Jorge Soler mainly is Jorge Bonifacio. He has a 747 OPS in the few games he's been up for, and he is up because Paulo Orlando is out for the rest of the season. He tore his MCL in one of the sims, so Paulo Orlando is no longer on the team for the rest of this year. He's on the 60-day DL. He's out for the rest of the season. He's also like 32. Doesn't really have too big of a future with us on this team. He's not really a guy I'm looking at. Maybe he'll be like a fourth outfielder for us next year, but right now he's definitely not a guy I'm like looking at as a guy who's going to be like a starter for us down the line. And now on to the part of the episode where I've been hinting about, where I'm going to go over what my plans are at the deadline, who I want to trade, what I'm going to do with certain guys, I want to bring them back. And first things first, you have the trade deadline, or you have the trading block screen up on your screen right now. First things first, Jason Hamill, 1,000% getting traded. He's tearing things up through 2 months. He's on he's got 1 year left in his contract. This is his final year. He's 35 years old. I'm going to try to trade him to a contender who needs a starter, who we can probably squeeze a couple good prospects from a team who's able to give up prospects for a right now trying to push for the World Series type team, especially since Hamill's been performing so well. Alex Gordon is a guy who I'm maybe going to trade at the deadline. He does not have 1 year left in his deal. He has this year plus next year, but I'm probably going to trade him in the offseason, I'm thinking. I'm not 100% sure about that, but it is a possibility that we trade him in the offseason, but he's probably going to finish out the rest of the 2018 season on the Royals roster. Nate Karns is a guy who I maybe trade at the deadline. He's a guy who doesn't have the full service time, so he's not going to be a free agent, even though he's an older guy, but he's not going to really, I don't think he's going to get much at the deadline, and I think we can trade so many other people that we don't really need to trade Nate Karns, and Nate Karns could always just be like a decent starter for us if we need him next season, or maybe I'll trade him in the offseason. I'm not really sure what I want to do with him, but I have him up on the trading block just because he's just the guy who's there. Alcides Escobar, 1,000% getting traded at the deadline, and no matter what, he is a guy, obviously, who's been around in the Royals for a while. He was with the World Series winning team. He was with the team that lost in the World Series. He's been here forever. Unfortunately, he is getting up there in years. He's also not the type of player that I usually prefer to have in my team, a guy who's just a really aggressive bat, doesn't walk, doesn't get on base a lot. And I'm going to try to probably trade him to a competing team at the deadline as well. Probably gets decent prospects from, not the best, but decent. Lucas Duda, another guy, 1,000% getting traded at the deadline. Not sure what we're going to be able to get for him, but we are going to try to get something for him. Ian Kennedy is a guy who was 1,000% getting traded before the deadline as well. Ian Kennedy, he's the guy who's blocking people. I'd rather have like Jesse Hahn or somebody else as the fifth starter right now, but Ian Kennedy's just kind of there because he's getting paid so much. And now on the two names you do not see on that trading block screen, but I do want to talk about. First name up is Mike Moustakas. Obviously, we know he's on the last year of his contract. He only signed a one-year deal this past offseason. He is 29. He's going to be 30 next year. He is a good bat. Obviously, he's a great player, but I think I'm not going to trade him at the deadline. I'm probably not, especially since we're in first place. I probably would trade him if we were like a last place team or we just weren't in the playoff race. But since we are in the playoff race, I don't want to completely just dump everyone. So Mike Moustakas is probably going to stay on the team throughout the rest of the season. And then we're probably going to qualifying offer him in the offseason. If he accepts it, he accepts it. We'll have him for another year. If he doesn't, he doesn't. And we'll just get draft picked. We'll just get a draft pick for him signing with somebody else. Salvador Perez is another guy who, he's 27, and despite him not getting off to the best start this year, and by not the best, I mean just an awful start this year, and he's not a guy who's going to hit for a high OBP. That's not what he does. He's never hit for a high OBP in his career. He's a guy who's going to knock in a few home runs, but his real value is the fact that he's Salvador Perez, and he can hit decently well or pretty well. He's just not going to get on base a ton. So he can hit decently, or like I said, he can hit pretty well, and he's also an extremely good defensive catcher, and that's an upgrade on literally like every team in the major leagues except for like two, because most catchers in the league just can't hit at all, and they're just guys who just sit back there and hit like 119. I'm exaggerating, obviously, but it's definitely better to have someone who has the potential of hitting like Salvi than it is to have like a Drew Butera as our everyday catcher. So what I'm probably going to do with him is offer him the qualifying offer and then also offer him like a 2 to 3 year deal, see if he accepts that. If he doesn't and he signs with somebody else or he accepts the qualifying offer, whatever, then, you know, that's fine too. But I'm not trying to let him walk. He's going to be on the team next season. I will try to bring him back. And now I know this is the May recap and we still have the June recap, which will be mainly focused on the MLB entry draft. And then, of course, we have the July recap, which will be mainly focused on the deadline. But we still have those months together, and I understand there's still a few episodes we have to post before we get to the deadline. But I did want to just talk about what my plans are with a couple guys at the deadline. So with that being said, that's going to wrap things up here for this edition of the monthly recap as we end May and head into the month of June. I've been your host, Jerseyborn, and I'm saying goodbye. And all-